Good morning. Welcome to Salem Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here to worship with us in the middle of America where it's hot and muggy and all of these things that they told me when I was moving from East Tennessee to West Tennessee and how hot it was going to be. Y'all lied. It's not true. Snow and everything. But you just hang on. It'll get there. we are thrilled that you were able to safely come out and worship with us. So I appreciate that. And I know that it was difficult on mornings like this to get up and come out, but it shows that if you can make it, it is very important for us to gather together and worship. So thank you for that. And as we continue this time of worship, would you bow your heads and pray with me? Heavenly Father, we love you so very much, and we thank you for the opportunity to worship you here. And even though a lot of our church family were unable to make it because of the weather, we thank you that we were able to safely get here. But I know that they're worshiping you wherever they are. I thank you for that, and I thank you for this opportunity that we can come together as more than two or three and worship you this morning. So I thank you for that, Lord. I ask you to take our worship, Lord, and let it be pleasing in your sight. We love you so very much, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Love is in the air, being talked about, being hoped for. And I couldn't help but think of you, and I just wanted to let you know how much you mean to me. Before I met you, my life was empty. I started to wonder if anyone out there noticed me. And then when you came into the picture, everything started to change. When I heard how majestic you were, I thought it couldn't be possible. Beauty no words could describe. Splendor only fit for the highest royalty. I started looking for flaws in you because, well, I thought you were too good to be true. How could someone like you care about someone like me? And yet there you were, ready and willing to accept me with all my flaws and failures, ready to risk your reputation to be associated with me. And that's what I love about you. I know I don't say it much. I know I don't show it enough. I know I put other things before and above you. I know sometimes I forget to honor you the way you deserve to be honored. But I know I've been bought with a price that I can never repay. I know I'm a sinner saved by your grace. So for all the times that I haven't said it and should have, may this stand as a letter of intention. I love you. I'm sorry for forgetting you. Forgive me for choosing anything over you. Help me see human love is a reflection and symbol of the perfect love only you have for me. My first love.
Taken me to higher ground, on the solid rock I stand. is carrying me so far, never going back again. All my life I give it now, all I am I lay it down. Lord, I surrender everything. Love lifted me, love lifted me.
Beautiful, beautiful song by a beautiful young lady. Thank you, RJ. We're just so blessed to have the Tate family with us. They're so talented, and I appreciate them always leading us in worship every Sunday. Thank you. God bless you. And Mac and Noah said those Tate girls are pretty easy on the eyes, too, right? And so awesome, awesome. We love you. Well, happy Valentine's on this snowy Sunday. Happy Valentine's to you all. I hope that you have already been wished a happy Valentine's Day. My Valentine is at home, still on quarantine. So one more week to go, and we'll be back to some kind of normal routine, hopefully. But I appreciate you being here today. Our theme today is just, God just set it up for us today. He made it too easy for us today, didn't he? Our theme today is just, is love. And so we want to experience love for one another and certainly the love of God. Did you know that God loves you? He loves you so much. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God loves you. And God expressed his great love to you by sending his Son in the world so that he could adopt us as his children. He didn't hire us, does he? He doesn't enslave us, does he? He adopts us into his family. Well, this morning, we're in for a real treat to hear the story of God's great love from our dear friend, Cindy Poole. Brother Randy is preaching for the next couple of weeks at First Baptist Medina, and so our prayers are with him, but we're honored to have the best part of the Poole household with us today, Miss Cindy, and she's going to come and share a word of testimony of God's great love. So if you would, give a good Salem welcome to our friend, Cindy Poole.
Thank you for sharing that song. I don't know where she's sitting, but it's so true. When nothing else would help, God lifted me. And I get excited, but I really covet your prayers right now because my daughter, or one of my three children, my youngest daughter, she's like me. We just kind of go all over the place sometimes with our thoughts, and so I have to just try to pull it back in because there's so much I want to say. But I'm with Brother Joel on this about the God's love, and then quoting that verse. What was that? Porque de tal manera amó Dios al mundo que ha dado a su hijo unigénito para que todo quien él cree no se pierda, mas tenga vida eterna. 1:3:16. And that was a dream of mine back when I was a little girl. Never realized what God would be doing in my life to get me to the point that I could share the gospel even in other countries in another language. But God is amazing. And when you give your life to Him, He does amazing things beyond anything you ever thought He could do. One of the reasons that it's a little bit difficult for me to share my testimonies because it is pretty strong, but I struggled with it after several times of sharing, and one day I spoke to the Lord and I said, you know, I just don't know if I could keep doing this. And the Lord just calmed my soul and He said, Cindy, because I told Him, I said, I felt like I kept reliving some of the events. And He said, Cindy, there are people out there who need to know Me, and you need to give that testimony. Amen. And so with that in mind, He's really touched my heart in that, to be able to share. And I like to always, I'm going to encourage you to go home. I always like to share this story of Joseph, and we don't have time to go into all of that, but his life, when you go home and you read about Joseph, and of course there's all this background that I would not have time to go into, but go back to Genesis 37. From there, just read his story on out to the end of the book. But Joseph, and you know, he was the one of 12 brothers, and life changed in a moment's time for him, and not for the best. And that young man, he was 17 when it happened. And I'm speaking to young people as well as adults. There are things that come into your life that just sweep you off your feet, and they were never planned. But you know something that I've always told the ladies in my women's conferences? I said, you know, and I would ask them, do you believe that God is sovereign? Always, 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 always in control. Do you believe that? He's always, 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 always in control. Why do I say it like that? Because that means everything, and this is not easy, but everything that happens in our lives is either allowed or done by our Father. Amen. If He's always in control. And there are things that happen that we say, oh, those are ugly, and they're awful, and they hurt. Why would God do that? He's always in control. So He either allows it for a reason. He was in control when Joseph was taken and betrayed by his brothers. And some of the things that I like to point out, the feelings that maybe I would have had, that Joseph, the young man, had, but the feelings of being lonely, because you know the story of Joseph, how he was sold into slavery. First, he was betrayed by his brothers, and first they wanted to kill him, get him out of the way. They hated him. The scripture says they hated him. He was favored by his father, but hated by his brothers. His family betrayed him. They plotted to kill him. One brother stood up for him, wanted to come back. Said, let's just throw him in the pit, you know, because in his mind, he was going to come back and save him. Later, he was sold into slavery, so he felt betrayed by his family. He felt, what do you think you would feel? Lonely, hurt. Have you ever felt betrayed? Lied to, lied about. Makes us angry. He was scared. He was robbed of his childhood, of his family, of his beautiful coat that reminded him of his father. He was humiliated because he was sold into slavery and made into a slave. They had slaves in their home, but he became a slave. And guess what? In a new culture, a different language, different food, different place, heathen gods all around him. He was not raised in that. Everything was different. Oh, all those emotions that he had. And then we know the story. He was placed in Potiphar's home, and there he was lied about, tempted, wrongly accused, unjustly punished when he was thrown into prison, and then even forgotten when he tried to help others with their dreams and interpretations, and forgotten and left. Of course, we know the story goes on as we read it, that God was always there. You know, we never hear about Joseph complaining or angry with God. What have you done? What is happening to me? Why is this happening? It's okay, I believe, to ask our Father why, because He is our Father, and we do that. But Joseph did as God led him to do through the dreams. And then I want to read something to you as Joseph, little by little, gave his life over to what God was doing in his life. And he didn't give up, and he didn't let the anger and the bitterness take root. See, that's a key. We talk about Valentine's Day and love, and what I'm going to share a little bit later, my testimony, and the symbol of that is right there. That's the greatest love symbol, a card you could get covered in red. Because God loves us so much. He loves you, each and every one of you. He loves me. And there is hope. There's faith, hope, and love. And what is the greatest of these? Love. Love gives us faith. Love gives us hope. Love, pure love, loves us. And that was Jesus Christ. But something happened at the end of all that Joseph went through. And I just wish we could do this study, but there's something said at the end when Joseph, his brothers come back, and he finally reveals his identity to his brothers, weeping because he knew what they felt. He had been through that whole gamut of feelings, and now they were covered with guilt and felt like something bad was going to happen to them because of what they felt like they had done to their brother, that they were fixing to be really punished. And Joseph, and he wept. It says all of the Egyptians heard it because he wept so loudly, chapter 45 of Genesis. And Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Is my father still alive? But they couldn't answer him. They were dismayed. They were in shock. And Joseph wanted them to get closer. He said, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. But then he says some amazing things to his brothers. He says, now do not be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. Did you get that? All of that, God allowing these things to happen. God doesn't do evil, but He is God. He could take it all away, but then we wouldn't have a choice whether or not to love Him. And that's why God loves us. He wants us to have a choice. He doesn't want us to be forced into loving Him. He made us. He created us. You know, we always hear the phrase, we're all God's children. That's not true. We are all His creation, and He loves us, each and every one. But not all are His children. He wills that all men be saved, the Scripture teaches us. Are they? No. For thousands of years, God has lost people to hell. But He loves us, and He keeps putting that story out there. So He said, God sent me before you to preserve life. So there was a famine in the land, and God was going to use him to gather food so that that famine could be, they could get through that famine, they could survive. Again, in verse 7, he says, God sent me before you. He keeps saying that. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant in the earth and to keep you alive by great deliverance. In verse 8, now therefore, as if we didn't get it the first or second time, it is not you who sent me here, but God. God had a plan to preserve life through Joseph. And because of that, the story came down through all of the centuries to us so that we could know Jesus. He had a story and He had a plan and He was working it all those years because He loves each and every one of us so much. And I'm passionate about sharing that love because I know what that love can do. It can transform. It changes your life. It changes who you are. My parents were, well, they had three children. And I had an older brother. Actually, they had four. I had an older brother. And then a sister came along. Well, three other girls came along. The second daughter died at about two and a half, with the water on the brain. And then I came along, and then my sister. And my parents were not Christian. I would say probably both of them were alcoholic. They both drank. They would go to bars. We even lived in the basement of a bar for a period of time. I remember some experiences out of that. And they would fight and scream. And so one day they decided that they would split up. And so back in those days, the courts awarded the children to the mother. In our case, that was not the best decision, but God was always there. And I learned that a little bit later. But during that time, my mother began to travel the country and, well, all over the United States, who knows. And she had all kinds of friends, and they were male friends. And so we went through a lot of stuff, and you know what I'm talking about. Little girls, little boy. We were physically, spiritually, mentally abused by these drunk friends in her life, and it was a bad life. And I remember her traveling in the car and sometimes being really hungry. And I remember stopping by a roadside stand one time and getting peaches. And that was the first time I remember eating a peach. I love peaches to this day. But just little things like that. And so I can remember an incident when we were staying in someone's home and my mother had went out and came back drunk with a friend. And he just threw open our bedroom door and started beating us with a belt. And don't know why, I just remember that happening. And I was about 5 years old. And we were not potty trained. We were malnutritioned. We weren't well dressed. So one day she decided that she would leave with this man. I try very hard to be careful with names because I know this will be out there, and that's okay. I want people to understand God's love. God was always there. And when she decided we were extra baggage for her, she took us to grandmother. My real father at that time was working in Chicago, and you know, back in those days, when you got a job, you hung on to it. And so he couldn't just leave. So she brought us to his mother, his parents, our grandparents, Morris Chapel. They lived up in Morris Chapel. And that day, we got out of the car. I was 5. My sister was 2. And my brother at that time was already living with Grandma. And so Grandma comes to the door. And I learned this as an adult a few years back when my real father had cancer and I nursed him through hospice until he went to meet Jesus, which I know he got saved. And I got to sit with him many, many weeks and ask Daddy, what happened? Why didn't you stay together? Tell me about that situation. And he tells the story that we were brought to grandmother and we got out of the car and she met my mother at the door and she said, why are you bringing the children here? You know, I have the boy, and we're old and sickly. We can't take care of everybody. And mother said, well, you need to. I'll be back, but just for a short time, just for a few weeks. And so she started to bring our clothes out, the box of clothes, and so grandmother said, well, you just need to take care of them yourself. And she said, okay. So she puts the box back in the car. She starts to get back in. Grandmother says, well, where are you going? She says, well, down the road, there's a store. I'm just going to take the girls and the box and go down to the store, and I'll leave them right there. Somebody will come by and pick them up. And when my daddy told me that, I said, she abandoned us. She left. And so, see, I had to come home and deal with that again. So when you grow as a Christian and you give your life to him, it doesn't all get perfect at that moment. He makes you perfect in the blood of Jesus. You are accepted fully. But life is tough and can throw things at you that you're not expecting. I didn't expect that. And as had been a missionary and now home and as an adult, and yet I'm sitting there crying like a baby, saying all over again, feeling that abandonment, that betrayal, that anger, that hurt, the things I wanted to think about her. And yet when I went home, I wept because I knew that she didn't know Jesus. I don't know that she ever accepted him. And that grieves my heart. And I pity her for what she gave up. So I had to deal with those feelings all over again. And as I walked with my dad through hospice, I had to learn to forgive. And see, that's the story. That's the true love story right there. That God loves us so much that he forgives us of our sins. So these addictions that my parents went through, and sometimes I think things that they pass on to me that I have to deal with in my mind, and know that God is always, 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 always in control. Wow. Whew. I'm glad he is. I'm glad I don't have to control or worry about my steps as long as I worry staying focused on him. I just want to stay focused on him. And then he takes care of the steps. And the direction, and your life, and what's going to happen. And then you can always trust that whatever happens, well, it's here for a reason. It happened for a reason. It's there for a reason. Because he loves me. And so she left us, and God had a plan, always has, from the beginning of time. And so that very weekend, when grandmother called my real dad and said, you need to come down here. You've got some girls, and we don't know what to do. Our hands are full. So Daddy came down, and that weekend, he had an uncle. See, it's all in the family. He had an uncle that called and said, I need to come talk to you. So this man, his wife came, his uncle and his aunt came to talk to my daddy and says, no, you're having a tough time. Well, you know our situation. We've always wanted to have children. And they tried to adopt before. And it fell through. And I wonder why. Because God had a plan. And we were going to be a part of their family. And so that very weekend, an agreement was made that we would be adopted by this couple. And it was kept in the family. My dad, my real dad, was allowed to stay connected, came for birthdays, Christmas, all those wonderful holidays in and out of our lives. It was great. My mother, on the other hand, she wrote ugly letters, and then she talked to my younger sister when she was 14 to run away from home. And my brother went to live down there with his family. And to this day, there has been so much that has happened in their lives because of that, because they went there. And her influence, see, parents, grandparents have an influence on children's lives. They do. And I pray for my grandchildren. I pray for my children every single day because I want to set a good example. And so there was so much destruction in their lives because of the example that my parents, but specifically my mother, set. And so God kept working in my life. So there I was, a teenager now. My sister was gone. And I struggled with that. And from the time I was a young girl, I prayed and prayed. I had a good Sunday school teacher. I went to Laneview, just down the road, and Miss Carter was our praying teacher. We called her our crying praying teacher because she cried every time she prayed for us. And she prayed for us, and she took me into her home. We had around 30 young people at that time, and of all the young people, she pulled me out of the group. See, God knew there was something there, and she pulled me out of the group and took me to her home on Sundays to have tea, because she was from the north, so we had tea in the afternoon. And I always loved that. I felt so special. And she would go through the lesson with me. So that night, we had training union on Sunday night at that time. And I would be prepared, because she would go through the lesson. And we talked, and she cried, and she prayed for all of us. But she prayed with me. And I learned about prayer through her. And that was a good thing, because you need to pray all the time. You need to talk to God all the time. And I got to know him even before I knew I needed him. I knew he was the one I was supposed to talk to, and that was very important. So at the age of 10, our church had a vacation Bible school, and I'm a firm believer in vacation Bible school. I don't remember everything that was said or done, except that one night when the pastor was talking about that God could come in and clean your life up and start all over with a brand new slate. And that captivated me, because I was 10 years old and I felt like trash. And I felt dirty. I felt like things that had happened to us or been done to us was my fault. And I just had not figured it out yet. What did I do? And I felt dirty, and I felt just all these things. And when he said that God could wipe the slate clean, can you imagine what that 10-year-old girl must have felt like? I ran down the aisle. I threw myself at the altar, and the pastor prayed with me. And I said, Jesus, save me. Save me. And he did. That was my Valentine's Day. He wrapped his arms around me, and he loved me, and he cleansed my life of all that guilt, all that shame, all that sin that was in my life bound up. And then several months later, still at the age of 10, God laid the call of missions on my heart, and I answered that call to be a missionary at 10 years of age. And a lot happened since then. You say, well, sounds like God worked it all out. Well, he kept working because he needed to, and I needed it. Because when we were adopted by this couple, my mother, again, my mother, but this time when I say mom and dad, I'm talking about the ones who adopted me, those that I love so much and have gone on to be with Jesus. But my parents were strict. But my dad was a little more laid back. But my mother, she was pretty tough on us. I guess she thought we needed it. I'm sure God knew I needed it. They say when they first adopted us that they had to sit at the back pew so they could take me out, because the first few weeks when the preacher would raise his voice, back in those days, you know, they'd preach hellfire and brimstone, Brother Joel. And he'd raise that voice. Well, see, by that time, the mark of a male raising his voice to me had done made, well, it had made its mark. And I didn't like it. So I stood up on the back of the pew at 5 years of age, giving the pastor what for in some very colorful language that I had learned in the bars. That, thank God, I don't remember. She had to tell me that story. She said, we had to take you outside, just whip and whip and whip you. Whip it right out of you. But evidently, I could tell him a few things or two. But so mother had her hands full. We had baggage. See, God could have picked out some other family, maybe more refined, you know, had a little more money. They were just country folk. But God knew what my soul needed, how I needed to be shaped and transformed. And he kept working in my life, and he used them, and I loved them. But it wasn't always that way. Because my mother was that strict, I began to develop some feelings against her that were not good. And I was angry. And of course, as a teenager, it's even worse because you got all this other stuff going on inside. And then I lived in two worlds. I lived in a home with parents who did not finish high school, who lived very basic life, who did not have a lot of money, who were very country. And then I'd go to school, and the kids knew there was something different. So there was a lot bullying and all of that going on. And I came home, ride the bus, cry, say, Lord, guess who I talked to? Lord, I need you. I don't understand this. And I was just always a little bit behind someone else. And God kept loving me and teaching me through that. And I didn't understand all that he was doing at that time, but I, like Joseph, had to be patient and let go and let God. We had to pick cotton at a young age. So 7 or 8, I learned tough lessons about the work ethic and being out in that cotton patch and hating it and hating, didn't want to say it at that time, but I did. I thought I hated mama, daddy, have to go through all of that. But I remember lessons that God taught me while out in that cotton patch. See, I was afraid the hot sun, working that hard, if I didn't keep up the pace, mom would get a cotton bowl switch. She liked fly swatter, cotton bowl switch, whatever she'd get her hands on. Everybody knows what I'm talking about. Someone. And it was tough. It was tough love. And God didn't take it away. He could have, but he allowed it. because he knew that one day I would go to Costa Rica, Honduras, Nicaragua, and all these Central American countries, mission trips, and be talking to kids who were going through this stuff. And then I'd meet women in my conference saying, this happened to me in my life, and I've been so angry and bitter. We have to learn forgiveness. God forgave us, and if we, as a believer, love God, we show that by our love and forgiveness for others.
That's right.
Even the ones that hurt us most, even our enemies, even people we don't like. And there's probably a lot of people out there we don't like right now, but we're supposed to love them. Pray for them. You know what Jesus said? Do good to them. What would I do if Kamala Harris walked through my house today? Hey, have a seat at my table. Fried chicken, cream potatoes. Come on. Love, do good, pray for. God, I don't know how to do that. But you know something? When my adopted mother, when I had developed these feelings toward her, when we came back from the field after 11 years of being a missionary, Randy went right on in being a missionary in Gibson County and all over West Tennessee. He fit right in. His job was there. Guess what? My mother developed Alzheimer's. My father had passed. My mother developed Alzheimer's, and I found myself taking care of her, and I was angry with God. I knew I wasn't supposed to be, but I kept thinking, Lord, I have been 11 years. I have taught over 300 children at a time. I've had Backyard Bible Club. We've developed a ministry center that's still going down there in the south of Honduras. And I come back here and I'm taking care of my mother. Why? And I remember as months and then years started going by, she lived with us. I had to take care of her. So she wouldn't wander off, so she wouldn't do things to herself. And it was hard, and she would say things as people who have Alzheimer's do, and it would hurt. And I remember being so upset one day that I felt like I was wasting my time. And I went to God and I said, you know what? I don't understand this, God. I want to be Christian. I do love my mother, I do. But I don't understand this. She's not getting any better. She's not learning anything. I can't teach her anything. Why don't you just take her home? And I knew when I said it didn't sound right. I'm praying that God would take my mama. And I thought, why would a missionary, what do I as a believer have the right to say that? Why would I say that about my mom? Something must be wrong. And God said, Cindy, this is not for her. This is for you. And I thought, oh God, what do I need? And I went back to him again saying, please shape me. I don't want to refuse it. See, that's the key too in growing in the Lord is you want God to do things. Don't refuse it. Don't back off. Don't run from it. When things happen, say, okay, I don't like it. I want you to know I don't like it, but I sure want to learn from it because you know what, God? I love you more than anything in all the world. See, Jesus became my first love at 10 years of age. And I always tell that to Randy. Valentine's Day, we say we love each other. And I say, yeah, I love you too, honey. But you know who my first love is. And he smiles because he knows. And guess what? This morning, for the first time, he said to me, Cindy, I love you so much, but you're number two. Yes, he got it. But God was working in my life, and I knew I had to forgive my mom, but I didn't know how. So I just made myself available. Here I am, Lord. That's all he asked each of us to do, be available. Here I am, Lord. Use me. Teach me. I love you, and I just want to honor you. Was that song we sang? I want to honor you in all that I do. I want to honor you. And I do. And he did. And so 10 and a half years, almost 11, I took care of mom. Day in, day out, same conversation. Got to the point I'd bring her breakfast and say, Mom. And I remember one day praying to God. I said, God, okay, I will do this. I want to do this. I don't know what you're doing, but I pray for one thing. I pray that you help me learn to love my mother without any strings attached. I want your love. I don't want to just say it because that's what Christians are supposed to do, because that's what a missionary is supposed to say. I just want to love her. I don't know how you're going to do it. 2.5 years, bring her breakfast. Hi, Mom, how you doing? I'm fine, how are you? You know, and all through that, there would be times she couldn't remember my name. I remember one morning I said something to her, and I called her mom, and she said, I am not your mom. And I cried and cried and cried. But I knew she didn't mean it, and she'd say ugly things, but she didn't mean it. I knew that was not my mother talking. I took care of her, and I remember one morning I brought her breakfast, same conversation. As I turned to leave, there was such a love that hit me from head to toe. And I stopped at the door, and I turned around, and I knelt down, and I put my hands on her knees, and I said, Mama, because I had loved her like I should have. And I said, I love you. All the things that I had experienced from my mother who abandoned me, and then the life that I had to live growing up as a teenager in that home until I left for going to Union University. And all of that just flooded over me. I loved her. And I knelt down and I said, I love you. And I looked into her eyes and I said, you taught me about taking care of children through babysitting. You raised me, taught me to sew, garden, all these skills in my life. You were a good mom. God is a good God. And he lets things happen in our life that are supposed to happen because he's shaping and molding. What he started with Adam shaping with his own hands in the dirt didn't stop. It created each one of us, and he's shaping and molding. These things come in your life for a reason. And I was able to forgive my mother, and it helped me to forgive my real mother who had left us. Forgiveness is such a key in our Christian walk. And I know that each of us have our own struggles, and they don't just go away. Sometimes we're struggling. Some days are better than others. It's okay. It's the Christian walk. Don't panic. He's always in control. Work with the day you have. That's all you have, is the day today. Give it to God and say, I just want to say, God, I love you. You are my first love. I just want to please you. So give your testimony when he encourages you to do so. Pray for someone. Help someone. Forgive someone when they've hurt you. Pray for people, no matter who they are or where they are. Love them. Because you know what? It was not you who sent me here, but God, to preserve life. Every time you are a good testimony, every time you are a good example, every time you're a person from your family who wants to love your family members, the ones that are even not likable, much less lovable, and you set that example that you're supposed to do, you don't know whose life you might be helping to preserve. It's true. Only God saves souls. Only God forgives sins. But we are to forgive people and love them and help them and pray for them. And I say that to you as much as to myself, because I want this church to love God and cherish him and cherish others and grow and be and do what they're supposed to be and do. I love my pastor. Randy and I have traveled and been in so many churches in different parts of the world and in all over the United States. And sometimes it was so difficult because there would be new faces and I'd have to adapt each time. But see, that transitional life that I had felt from my life before, through being adopted, through going into missions and living like Joseph in a different culture, different language. It was so hard sometimes, you know, being angry because they didn't think the way I thought. They didn't do things the way we did. And trying to adapt, and then having the children, and having children can be very trying at times. They don't think that we're supposed to think. They don't do what they're supposed to do. And growing through that, and now facing grandchildren. They don't do what they're supposed to do. But I love them and I pray for them. And we do that for each other. And as a church family, after many, many years, I have grown to love you guys so much. I don't know all your names. I don't know you. I hope to. I'm going to work hard at it. But I'm going to continue to pray for you because you're my family. And I love family. And when you've been through what I've been through, to have family torn apart, it's good. I remember as a young girl praying for a good husband. And Randy's been good. 43 years this year it will be. He's loved his kids. He's been faithful. And I have seen when you're not faithful. We hurt God's heart when we're not faithful to him. When we don't act like he's our first love, when we go off and get distracted by life's challenges. And so I just want to encourage you, and not to beleaguer this, but I want to encourage you to get to know your first love. And if you don't know him, know him. Because he tells us that if we will confess our sins, he will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And your life will be transformed. You will be so different. You will do that. I never thought as a little girl, and then as a teenager growing, that there would come a day that I could speak another language, that I could live in another culture, that I could just share the love of Christ in so many different ways, and then have the strength to caregive through four hospice, four family members, and watch them slip off into eternity. God allows things and God does things to preserve life. Do you want to be one of those that God is preserving life through? Make that your mission challenge today. Make that your heart's goal, and be able to say, my first love is Jesus. And if you don't know him, get to know him. He loves you so much. And if you'll join me in a word of prayer this morning. Ay, Padre, te amo tanto. Te amo por salvar mi vida y mi corazón y limpiarme. Gracias por todo lo que estás haciendo en mi vida. Yo también te ruego que toque la vida de cada persona que está aquí en la iglesia, que está en esta sala. Gracias por tu amor profundo y perfecto. Father God, I love you so much. Thank you for saving my soul. Thank you for changing me, transforming me, and every day conforming me to your Son. I want to know more. I pray for every heart here. Thank you for those you have changed. I pray for those that haven't been changed, God. Oh, God, thank you for this church. Thank you for the life beat, heartbeat of this church. And I just pray that you help them to just grow and help me to grow and let us grow as brothers and sisters, that someday we'll be ready when you come, oh Jesus, whatever day that is. Forgive us, oh forgive us of our sins. And every day make us clean and ready and usable. We are available to you, Father. We pray all of this in your precious, holy name and in your Son, Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus, for your greatest gift, your life for us. No greater love hath a brother than one that gives his life for another. You gave your life for us. Oh, I thank you for that. I praise your name for that. You are good. I pray all this in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Cindy. God bless you. I was sitting there thinking, what the world tries to throw away and discard, what the devil tries to call insignificant and invaluable, is what God cherishes and loves and uses. And God bless you, how he's taken such a difficult childhood and used you, Cindy, to lead so many people to eternal life through Jesus Christ. Praise God for that. Well, in just a moment, we're going to have an invitation. Before we do, I just want to draw your attention to a couple of things, since it's today's our emphasis is on the love of God. I don't know if you've had a chance to pick up a newsletter yet, but if you pick up one of our newsletters that we have available for you on the counters, on the front of it, in my article this year is, this month, is God's love letter to you. And I want you to read that, because this is how God feels about us. If the world discards us, God cherishes us. I'm going to pick just a few of these verses. I was going to read it all, but I won't take the time to do that. I want to pick just a few of these verses. Cameron, you can just leave that screen up there and you won't have to follow along. But listen to God's love letter to you. Before you were born, I desired to adopt you into my family by bringing you to myself through my son, Jesus. I wanted to do this. It gave me great pleasure. Even all the very hairs of your head are all numbered. I have searched you and know you. I know when you sit and when you rise. I perceive your thoughts from afar. I discern your going out and your lying down. I am familiar with all your ways. Before a word is on your tongue, I know it completely. I hem you in from behind, and I lay my hand upon you. Your transgressions have been forgiven. Your sin is covered. You are blessed. Instead of shame, you shall receive a double portion. Instead of dishonor, you shall have everlasting joy. Let me be enthralled by your beauty. Honor me, for I am your Lord. I am the Lord God who heals you. You are in Christ, and you are my new creation. The old is passed away. Behold, all things I make new. You know me. I dwell with you and will be in you. My Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth, for he will speak on not his own authority, but whatever he hears from me. I see all your hardships. I care about your suffering and the anguish of your soul. And when you call on me, when you're in trouble, I will rescue you. You can trust in me. I will never forsake you. Cast all your worries on me, because I really do care about you. Since you are in Christ, I've made you an heir of all of my promises. Keep your mind and your thoughts focused on me, and I will keep you in perfect peace. I am the Lord. I'm your shepherd. You will lack nothing. I will go before you. I will be with you. I will never leave you. Don't be afraid or discouraged. I will hold your hand. I will keep you from falling. I'm going to meet all your needs according to the riches that I have for you in Christ Jesus. Neither depth, nor height, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate you from my love in Christ Jesus. My love for you will persevere through every situation, and not one of my promises will ever fail you. Draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. Signed, your Heavenly Father, who loves you. God loves us so much. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Sometime today, before you go to bed, all right, thank God for loving you this much. Deal? Stand with me, church. We're going to invite you to make a decision for Jesus Christ right now. Brother Stephen and Wendy's going to come and lead us. I'll be down front here for you. Whatever Cindy may have spoken and God has used that to speak to your heart, you may want to come and kneel and pray for your loved ones. You may want to thank God. You may want to just do business with God in your seat. Whatever it is, listen to God's call on your heart. God, I pray this time, this most important time, we humble ourselves before you, and may your Holy Spirit have freedom to work in our lives. Thank you for sending the testimony, God, how you've taken an ugly situation and turned it into a beautiful light, a light of your glory. Thank you for that. Lord, don't stop doing those kinds of things. Do it in our life too, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.